Welcome back to the course. In week three, I talked about organizational fragmentation, unbundling, convergence, and the multi-actor environment. This web lecture is about governance and public values. When we privatize or liberalize public services in the world of transport, energy, or telecom, it's common sense to emphasize that public values should be safeguarded. A public value might be affordability. We shouldn't make a public service too expensive, denying people access to this service. Privatization and liberalization should not result in compromising quality, or safety, or accessibility, or sustainability. All these public values have to be safeguarded in a privatized environment. We can try to safeguard all these values by regulation, or by special conditions in a contract. We can formulate special conditions in a concession, or we can design a performance management system. The instrument depends obviously on the context. But before we start talking about the policy instruments to safeguard public values, there are four issues that have to be resolved. These issues are the identification of the most relevant public values, the trade-off between these values, the multi-actor context, and the question how to specify public values. Now, we'll now discuss these four issues in more detail. In a specific situation, we will of course identify the main public values. So in the case of public transport, public values might be affordability, reasonable ticket prices, quality, clean, modern buses, friendly and competent bus drivers, punctuality, no delays, and sustainability. The buses should be as green as possible. Now, the issue is that these public values will almost always be conflicting or competing. More quality and greener buses will probably result in higher costs, higher ticket prices, and in less affordability. So we always have to make a trade-off between competing values. This trade-off can change in the course of time. This is because of the simple fact that our preferences can change. So suppose a bus operator gets a concession for 8 years to exploit a network of bus lines. At first, the government emphasizes the public value of affordability. Reasonable prices are key to the government. Buses should be an attractive modality to everyone, including the low-income groups. But after a few years, the public value of sustainability might become important. A local government faced with high pollution levels, congestion, is looking for cleaner air and wants the bus operators to introduce whispering green electric buses. There are not only competing public values requiring a trade-off, but this trade-off might also be dynamic and change in the course of time. Safeguarding public values always takes place in what we call a multi-actor context. There are many actors involved with often diverging interests and opinion. So again, take the case of public transport. What are the main actors involved here? There's the bus operator, or perhaps there are several bus operators. There's a government. There are user organizations. There might be competing modalities, a metro operator, a train operator. There are the companies selling green and electric buses, and there are their competitors selling traditional buses. All these actors have a stake in bus transport, and they all have an opinion on what the relevant public values are and what the trade-off should be. Formally, a government offering a concession will make the decision on the public values and the trade-off between these values. But this government depends upon the support of the other players. They might have the expertise the government needs to define public values. They might have societal power. A user organization that doesn't agree with the trade-off can activate public resistance. So to summarize, there are not only competing public values requiring a trade-off. This trade-off is also dynamic and changes in the course of time. And there are also different actors involved with different opinions on what the relevant public values are, what the trade-off should be, and whose opinion might change over time. Finally, there's a very simple observation here. The devil is in the detail. It's easy to define public values at a high level of abstraction. We all agree with public values like affordability, quality, safety, accessibility, sustainability. These are all what we call feel-good concepts. You've just had a look at, just have a look at the following video. Most of you will agree with the framework presented for the future of shale gas.
Now, shale gas has caused a bit of controversy. Many people are against fracking, and indeed it's banned in some member states. How is this framework going to deal with all of that?
We're going to address both concerns, legitimate concerns, and also the potential which lies in this important area for those member states who choose to explore it. And we know that many member states, as many as 10, are preparing to take action in this area. So we need a framework, we need some principles in place, and that's what we're putting forward here, so that we can have shale gas play a role for those member states who choose to do so in the transition towards a low carbon economy. We think that it could be around 10% by 2035. So it's limited, but it's an area that where we need to make sure that we have both security in terms of environmental protection and mitigation of the risks that are involved in exploring and using this technology and doing fracking, as we call it, and also that we have transparency so that people know what is happening. So we are putting basic principles in place here so that we actually have a good principled framework in place for fracking in the future.
But the question, of course, is how do we make these values specific? Coming back to the example of the bus, what exactly is affordability? What is a reasonable price for a ticket? What actually is quality? How do we define punctuality? Safeguarding public values might mean that you have to dive into the details. And that's rather paradoxical. Privatization is aimed at using the power of the market, but will often result in more detailed regulation. And that is not the first connotation we have when we discuss the power of the market. So safeguarding public values is not an easy thing given these four issues. An example. Suppose a bus operator will get a concession to exploit a network of lines. A trade-off of public values will be made, and each public value will be made specific. It will be operationalized. For example, punctuality means that each bus should arrive and leave on schedule. If the bus arrives or leaves more than 3 minutes later, the performance is not punctual. So punctuality is defined as a bus arriving and leaving less than 3 minutes later than the scheduled time. How will a government safeguard these public values? For example, by imposing a penalty. When at the end of the year, say 5% of the buses has had a more than 3 minutes delay, the bus operator will get a penalty, which will of course depend on the percentage of delayed buses. This is called a high impact performance management system. You have to perform. If you don't perform well, you will get a penalty. The idea is that you will do everything you can to perform well given this penalty. However, a high impact system might lead to another type of behavior. If you simply can't meet the performance criteria, if only 5% delays is too ambitious a figure, a high impact system might also result in perverse behavior. How to meet the 5% norm? Well, you might change the timetable. Simply take more time for the rides, and you will easily meet the 5% criterion and have high performing bus routes. And is it high performance? Is it the high performance if buses are overcrowded? Another example of perverse effects of performance management systems. A bus driver has to leave from the station at 10 o'clock. He knows that another bus will arrive at 5 past 10. This bus is a bit delayed. In this other bus are several passengers that want to change at the bus station, that want to take the bus of our driver. The driver, however, is so much focused on leaving on time that he leaves at 3 minutes past 10, and that he is not willing to wait for 2 extra minutes to serve the passengers that want to change. Again, on paper, this is a well-performing bus driver, but everyone will understand in the real world this behavior is not good. How to prevent these perverse effects? One of the main lessons in the literature is that in this case, government and the bus operator should negotiate about the performance management system. When you negotiate, you can discuss possible perverse effects and try to design a system that prevents these effects. We might go one step further. In a multi-actor world, it might be wise to involve other actors, user organizations, in this process of negotiations. This completes the picture of safeguarding public values. Competing public values require a trade-off. This trade-off is dynamic. Different actors might have different opinions on public values. Public values have to be made specific. And this process requires cooperation between at least the principal, the government, and the agent, the bus operator. This to prevent perverse effects. Remember, whatever the policy instruments to safeguard public values is, it will almost always be a negotiate instrument.